Hello, everyone. This is criminal profiler Pat Brown, and today we're going to go back, 50 years. 50 years to 1972, actually 1971, 72, to the still unsolved case of the Freeway Phantom. This case, oh my goodness, it's one of the saddest cases. And as it happened, it was one of these cases where you had all these victims. There were six that were attributed to the Freeway Phantom. And these were young girls who were doing nothing more, for the most part, than walking to the store to buy some dog food, something as simple as that, and then were kidnapped, sexually assaulted, and murdered. And no one has ever been charged and convicted of the crime. Some people consider this the first serial killer in Washington, D.C. I personally doubt that. I'm pretty sure over the years in D.C. and vicinity, now called the DMV, in Maryland, Virginia, D.C., there have been other serial killers over the last 200 years. And I know that there were many cases when I was studying back in the, I think it was in the 90s, I had a specific focus on sexual homicides and serial killers. And I actually had my agency at the time was called the Sexual Homicide Exchange. And I looked into how many people, especially women, I believe have been killed by serial killers. And that label hadn't been attached to their homicide. And indeed, years later, some of them, it was quite interesting that maybe 10, 15, 20 years later, suddenly somebody was arrested. And lo and behold, one of those women I had said, this is a serial homicide, indeed was. And it turned out the guy was a serial killer. And then they had him linked to three or four people. But at the time, they didn't link them. Now, in this case, in the beginning, they didn't. But it became very hard not to say, hey, this is a serial killer. And so this case, no question, at a certain point, became known as a series of crimes committed by one person. So a very fascinating case. And the most interesting thing about this case is some of the profiling aspects. How do you profile a case like this? How do you identify a suspect? And if you identify a suspect, does that mean it is the guy who did it? So I'm gonna get into that. I think it's gonna be really interesting. Let me say hello to the people in the chat room. Who do we have here with us today? Let's see, Annie Haley is here. Texas Redhead is here, Sky Ricky's here, Leslie is here, Molly's just come in, and Lauren, Stephanie W. Local to you too. Looking forward to hearing Pat's take on this case. It's very local to me because I grew up in the Washington DC area and in Virginia, but in 1972 I was still lurking mostly around Virginia, but my connections to DC happened a little bit later. Kathy Chapin is here. More people are coming in. And so I probably won't get you guys when you come in. But if you would like to be in the chat room for these live shows, please do join Patreon. The link is in the description below. Being part of Patreon, it's only $5 a month, supports the channel. It's an educational channel, so it needs support. But you can be part of a very nice community and be at the live shows. I want to let you know, however, if you don't join Patreon, you can still see every one of my videos. The purpose of my videos is educational. So I want them to be out there, especially for people, maybe detectives, people in criminal justice, people who want to learn more about profiling. I want them to be able to access any of my videos at any time. So they're all public, but please do subscribe to the channel. That also does help support the channel. Hit the bell for notifications, and you can support the channel other ways, like, hey, my book is below. This is a fiction book, Only the Truth. It's a psychological fiction book. It's in the description, links you to Amazon. It's $2.99, help support the channel. Okay, now let's get to the case. All right, I'm gonna get the sweater off now. I always start off cold, and as soon as I start talking, I get toasty. So, all right. Now, let's see. Six girls. Now, the best way for me to start this, because there's a lot of information, but I do want you to hear a little bit about each victim and how she got kidnapped, and how she ended up dead and where, because these are important things when it comes to profiling. So you need to know a little bit. Now, you're not going to keep all this in your head because I'm having trouble with it. But I just want you to get a good feeling for what happened to these girls. So let's start with the top row of these girls. Let me put up their pictures with their names because that's the only way I'm going to remember. All right. First girl that got kidnapped. Her name was Carol Denise Spinks. And yes, I am getting this from good old Wikipedia because they have the shorter version rather than the very long explanations. On the evening of April 25th, 1971, 13-year-old, so keep in mind the ages, 13. She was from, and also keep in mind the locations they lived. They lived in Washington, D.C., all of them. I believe four of the bodies ended up in Prince George's County, just across the D.C. line, and two of them ended up on the D.C. side. So this is important as to where did this guy live? And so I believe three of the girls were from Southeast D.C., two of the girls were from Northwest D.C. and one from Northeast, I believe. And it's kind of like it's a kind of a half a diamond D.C. I'll be showing you some maps later. So they're different neighborhoods and they do have a reasonable distance apart. If you were walking, you certainly would. These were fairly far apart. Taking the bus, you could get to every neighborhood. Driving, of course, is the easier way. And, you know, from one neighborhood to the other by car, it might be 10 minutes. So we're not talking about an hour distance or, that spread out like Los Angeles. We're talking about you could get from one area to the other 10, 12 minutes. So they're all in Washington, D.C., but not all in exactly the same neighborhood. And this is important. All right. So Carol Spinks. She was sent to the store by her older sister to buy groceries at a 7-Eleven, located about a half a mile away from her home, just across the border in Maryland. So she was from Washington, D.C., but she did cross the border. On her way home from the store, Spinks was abducted. So they saw her at the store, then she was gone. Her body was found 6 days later at 2:46 p.m. behind St. Elizabeth's Hospital. Now, St. Elizabeth's Hospital is going to play an important part in the profiling aspects of this crime. So let me see if I can find you a basic picture of... I try to put together a whole bunch of maps and they probably suck. So I apologize for that. And as I always point out, they're really, really teeny on this program and I can't make them bigger. So I may just throw up a bunch until I find the right one because they're not labeled. So let me see. I wanted to point out to you St. Elizabeth's Hospital. Good God, that's a small map. That's not so useful. It looked bigger when I had it on my own computer. Okay, there you can. Okay, you can see it there. All right. If you look down at the bottom where the little red circle is, it says St. Elizabeth's Hospital. And if you look up further, if you look up that blue line that's going up the map, it'll go to a place called Benning Road, Northeast. And there's that area. And on the other side, that would be Southeast. And then the Southeast is a little further down. I can't explain the whole map, but you're going to find that most of the bodies were along that corridor, that blue line going down the highway there. The bodies were chucked out of the car. And so this first one was found near to St. Elizabeth's Hospital there. And it's, she was found 6 days, let's say 6 days later behind the hospital on a grassy embankment next to the northbound lanes of I-295. Now, if you look at the highway thing there, it says 695, ignore that. It's basically 295. It's kind of a confusing thing on the map, but it's actually 295. So somebody drove down that highway, which is sort of DC's on one side and Prince George's County, Maryland's on the other. And they chucked her, out of there. So that's where she was dumped in St. Elizabeth's Hospital, or outside of that. That's kind of, it's confusing, but I just want you to get a sort of a basic idea of some of the map. It's really difficult here. I wish I should have, if I had money and some people to work with me, I would have done a whole fancy map, because there isn't one with any of the shows or any of the sites. I would have done a really great map or done a video of the whole darn thing. Oh, that would be great. It's not happening. Okay, so she was found also near the Suitland Parkway. And again, if you don't live in the area, you know, you really won't know what that all means. But it's just, those are just 295 goes down the side of the city. Suitland Parkway goes from one part of the city over to southeast. And that's where the bodies were basically found, in those areas near that highway. So somebody was traversing that area when they dumped the bodies. Examination revealed she had been both physically and sexually assaulted and strangled. She was dressed but missing her shoes, and had only been killed a few days previously. So she was missing for 6 days, but had been dead only about three. So therefore, the thought right here was that somebody had abducted her and kept her someplace where they sexually assaulted her and then killed her and then dumped her. So in other words, this wasn't the type of thing where somebody just grabbed her in a car, pulled over to the side of the road, raped and murdered her, and that was that. They took her someplace, which led the investigators to think guy must have a place to go to. You can't, and it probably is not going to be an apartment, because that's a really not a likely place to have to take a person into and then kill them and then have to get the body out, especially if you're going to do five more ladies. Probably had some private residence of some sort that he could access and bring somebody in without being seen, and that take a body out without being seen. So that's important. All right, so now let's go to the next girl. That's Darlenia Johnson. So on July 8th, so now we're talking, let's see, April. So 3 months later, 1971, she was 16 years old. She was taken from Congress Heights, and she was abducted while en route to her summer job at Oxon Hill Recreation Center. One witness reported having seen Johnson in an old black car driven by an African-American male shortly after her abduction. Whether that's true or not, again, as a witness, who knows. 11 days later, her body was located only 15 feet from where her body was found. Okay? So this is already where the red flag goes up and says serial killer. Because the chances of one serial killer dumping her at that location and the next serial killer rolling along just chucks the body in exactly the same location. Who would have thunk, you know? So already the likelihood of these two being connected is there. So let's see. She was dressed, but without her shoes, or she was far too decomposed to determine the cause of death or if she had been sexually assaulted. But law enforcement was able to find evidence of strangulation. So both the girls strangled, both the girls dumped, both the girls, Congress Heights. There's an interesting point with profiling later on where Kim Rossmo, who does geographical profiling, analyzed these crimes and had this center where he thought it was very important. And he believed that location was had a meaning, and it was Congress Heights. Now, an anchor point, he called it. But I don't know that I believe that entirely, that there's a great truth in that. Statistically, you might come up with something statistical to say so, but nobody's ever been proven to have come from Congress Heights, although they could have. The killer could have been a resident of Congress Heights, because sometimes you do work in a certain area. And this was, I guess, when he looked at it, it was centralized. Also, these two girls, and the last girl did come from very much the same area, so the guy could have lived in that area. And we'll examine that a little further as to why there might be some truth in that. All right, so then we go to Brenda Crockett. As you can see, she's much younger. In July 27th, that was only a couple weeks later, 10-year-old Brenda Crockett from Northwest. Now, she is in a different part of town. Okay. She failed to return home after having been sent to the store by her mother. So this is one of these things where people go, why are the mothers sending these young children to the store? And a lot of times it's explained, in a community situation, that it was common for girls to go off to the store, go get some milk, go get this, go get that. And theoretically, the neighborhood was a neighborhood where people knew you and they knew your kids and they go, hi, you know, the church lady's here and this person's there. Were they all the safest neighborhoods? No, but they, like maybe a drug dealer or two here and there, they weren't necessarily going to harm your child. They might sell your child drugs, but they didn't want to harm them because they were future customers. But generally speaking, you could walk through some of these neighborhoods and feel like if you sent your kid out there, people were watching and your kid wouldn't get kidnapped. And there's a lot of truth to that because in some places, like out in the suburbs, houses are too far apart and there's a lot of trees and it's easier that you disappear and people not seeing you because they aren't out on their porches and stuff like that. But I know my mother-in-law lived in D.C. And she had a little front porch. She was in a row house, like many of these kids were. And part of the family would always be out on that porch. And you could wave to other people on their porches. So when you saw a kid going down the street, you're like, hey, Brenda. I could see why they didn't think it was such a big deal to send their child down to the store. After all this happened, people started thinking differently. So Brenda, yeah, she was sent to the store by her mother. 2 hours later, around 9:20 at night, she'd been sent about 7 o'clock. And we're talking July, so it wasn't actually dark when she was sent. The Crockett's phone rang. And this is one of the weirdest parts of the case. And there may be a reason for this. Their phone rang, and it was answered by her 7-year-old sister, who had waited at home while her family searched the neighborhood for her. So the family's out looking for her, kids at home. And Brenda's on the other end of the line crying, and she says, a white man picked me up, and I'm heading home in a cab. Brenda Crockett also told her sister that she believed she was in Virginia before abruptly saying bye and hanging up. Then, a little later, the phone rang again. This time it was answered by the stepfather. She told the stepfather the same thing she had said in the first phone call. And then she added, did my mother see me? And she also indicated she was alone in a house with a white male. Her stepfather asked her to have the man come to the phone. Heavy footsteps were heard in the background and Crockett said, I'll see you, and hung up. Authorities quickly concluded that Crockett likely called her home at the behest of the killer. Okay, so clearly if the guy's got her in his clutches, the chances of him allowing her to use the phone without his permission, a little unlikely. So they thought the killer had her call and fed her inaccurate information to buy the necessary time to perpetrate the crime and to hamper the investigation. At 5:50 a.m. the next day, a hitchhiker discovered Crockett's shoeless body in a conspicuous location on U.S. Route 50 near the Baltimore-Washington Parkway. And here we go. We got Route 50 here, Baltimore-Washington Parkway here, which turns into 295, which we've been talking about, and then the Suitland Parkway. So again, it's just over the D.C. line in Prince George's County. They found her. She had been raped and strangled, and a scarf was knotted around her neck. All right. So one of the questions is, why did she say a white man took her to Virginia? What was the purpose of that? And the idea of the police was it just to distract and to make them look elsewhere, not look in D.C. and not look at a black man. That was the theory. Now, why would that be true? You can come up with a whole bunch of possibilities. These two girls, by this time, the theory is, oh, well, you know, somebody from the neighborhood. Maybe the guy did get afraid. Not so much that her mother saw her being. Some people thought it's because her mother might have seen, or she thought somebody was out there who would have seen the guy kidnapping her. So he changed his race from black to white so that would be a wrong witness, you know, witness didn't see it correctly. Or the other possibility is that he thought he might have been seen with Darlenia. Remember somebody saw her, I believe, thought they saw a guy in a car. Maybe he thought that, you know, when he took the next victim, I'll have her call and say it's a white guy so that whatever people saw back here, people wouldn't believe. Why did he say Virginia? There's a couple of possibilities there. One, of course, is that he didn't live in Virginia and he wants the police to waste their time. Another possibility is the reason the word Virginia popped into his mind is because that is where 295, if you keep going on 295, it'll eventually go to Virginia. Okay, it connects with the highway system and goes into Virginia. I'll show you that later with one of the suspects who did actually work in Virginia at the end of 295. So it's a little complicated, but I want at least to try to introduce you. Okay, so those are the first three victims. Then we're going to get to the next three victims here. Okay, this one. Okay, so now we have, I'm trying to pronounce her name, Nina Moshe Yates. She was 12 years old. She was walking home around 7 p.m. This is in October, so then it might be dark. 7 p.m. from a Safeway store in Northeast. So now we're not in Southeast Washington. We're in Northeast Washington for her. When she was kidnapped, raped, and strangled, her body was found within 3 hours of her abduction. 3 hours. Off the shoulder of Pennsylvania Avenue in Prince George's County. Again, right off of 295. So it's all, the bodies are basically dumped in sort of a line, which means to me, it's the same guy. And he has some, he uses that basic highway system. Found within 3 hours of her abduction. As with the other cases, her shoes are missing and unidentified green fibers would also be found on her clothing, which other were found on other girls as well. A witness apparently saw her getting into a blue Volkswagen. And although investigated, the lead led nowhere. Now here we have again the problem with witnesses. She got into a blue Volkswagen. That was 1971. I'm trying to think. My ex-husband had that blue Volkswagen. And two of these girls had connections to Cardozo High School, where my ex-husband was a student at. You see how you can link it to anybody? No kids, your daddy is not a serial killer. No, but there's this is what the police have to deal with. When you hear these different things, you can start putting the little lines, you know, and connecting dots, and you can get a guy here with five dots and a guy over here with, you know, three dots and a guy over here with 10 dots. Which one is it? Is it the 10 dot guy? Or if there's enough information, and this gets to be a real problem, if there's enough information and maybe wrong information, you can have so many dots connected to somebody, which actually have no meaning, or just there are, it's just that, yeah, that guy happened to go to the same high school and have this a vehicle, one witness thought, does that mean anything? You know, did he live in DC? Yes. Did he have a basement he could have? No, it's not him. But you can make those dots work. So you have to be careful. So whenever you're profiling or a detective, you can look at dots and you can say to yourself, okay, that's interesting. I use the word interesting because interesting rather than necessarily meaningful. Two different words. If you get more evidence, then it becomes meaningful. But in the beginning, it's just interesting. Somebody might want to look at further until you can eliminate them. So after this murder happened, the Freeway Phantom moniker was first used in the Daily News. So that's where the Freeway Phantom came from. Sorry. Didn't come from the killer. It came from the media, who likes to make up names, and then that makes the killer really happy. Okay, now we go to Brenda Woodard. This is a little bit different. After having dinner with a high school classmate, she was from Baltimore, and she was having some family issues, and a lot of people get very upset about the fact that she was older. She's 18. She's not a child. She's an adult. But she was going some classes. I think it was Cardozo High School, I think. And she was taking some buses. All right. And she had gone to Ben's Chili Bowl, which is a famous place in DC, to have some food with her friend. And then she got on a bus. And then I think she was at a transfer point. That's when she vanished. Now, what has been said about her is that, and this does play into when you're looking at suspects, that she was known to get into people's vehicles. Supposedly, if they give her a free ride, she'd give them a little something, something. You know, some people said she was into prostitution. So is that true or isn't it? Well, it could be, it could not be. Was she just grabbed, or did she willingly get into somebody's car? And did the person who committed all these crimes have any connection to the use of prostitutes or luring girls who might give them something in exchange for something else? And so her name has been a little sullied. But if you're an investigator, you can't just say, well, that's just mean. You have to look at those issues when you're looking at suspects. All right, let's go to the last woman. Was she a woman or a girl? Let me say. Denise Williams. And Denise Williams, the last girl, she was the niece of this a woman that wrote this book. Her name is Wilma Harper. Wilma Harper was her aunt. It was her aunt, and she was a social worker, the writer of this book. And she wrote the first book on the Freeway Phantom. It's called The Mystery of the Freeway Phantom. And it is not a book I don't believe you can find any place. Amazon didn't have printing back then. So she had it printed. I don't know how many she had printed or how many books sold. She gave me this copy. I went to visit her back and sometime after she wrote this, which was, when did she write this? She wrote this in 1983. I believe I met her in the 90s. She was a wonderful lady. I met her when she was in her 80s. She was really sweet. I went to her home and she had all these, she was a runner and she had all these trophies and all these medals just lining the wall. And I said, wow, you have so many of them. She goes, yes, I got an awful lot of these in my last year of life, my last 10 years of life, because when I show up, I'm the only person in my division. So I always win. She had a great sense of humor, a really sweet person. And her book isn't so much detailing all the crimes. So you won't get that much out of the book in that. She was detailing the social issues, what a serial killer is, how a serial killer would develop, why six black girls became targets, how the police responded, how the community responded. So it's a really nice sociological study. So, and I wish I could tell you could get it, but I don't think you can. But I looked into it at the time because I had the sexual homicide exchange and I was looking into different series of murders, serial murders in the Washington, D.C. area. So you know, we had a really nice time together. And I can't remember that much more from way back then, but it's interesting to revisit it. But Diane Williams was her niece. And what happened to her? She was the last victim that they know of. Always say that when you're looking at a series, that they know of, because he could have changed methodology. He could have taken a few years off and then killed somebody somewhere slightly in another location. Sometimes serial killers have problems with stability and therefore they might live here and kill here. And then, you know, something goes wrong in their life and they go live with cousin Ernie in North Carolina. And all of a sudden there's some murders in North Carolina, some girls who are raped and strangled. But rape and strangle girls is a very common thing among serial killers. So the problem is there's not those signatures you see in all the television shows, you know, so you don't really know if it's the same guy or not the same guy. And there have been some cases where the serial killer changes his MO so much that you think it's six different murderers when it's one. And I've seen other situations where it looked like one guy and it turned out to be three. So I can only say this is the last one that we know of in the Washington, D.C. area as Diane Williams. She was going to Ballou High School, which is in Southeast Washington. So the first two girls were Southeast Washington, and so was she. She cooked dinner for her family and then visited her boyfriend's home. She was last seen boarding a bus. So she had a bus issue and she had a bus issue. She was boarded that bus at 11:20. Near his house. And a few hours later, her strangled body was discovered dumped along I-295. And that's quite quickly, a few hours later. So whoever kidnapped her at 11 at night had, if he's going to bring her to her home, and I don't know that he did, it's a little confusing. Her shoes were missing, but no other signs of sexual assault were found. Although there was some semen that was found, presumed to be her boyfriend's, on her clothing. So, and they did eventually turn that in years later, but there's no information on whatever happened with the results. But if there was any evidence that she was taken someplace like the others and kept and attacked and then dumped, you would have to assume that the route he took after grabbing her, He had to be able to get to his home, accomplish things, and then get back out again within that time period. Or this time he didn't go home. This time he killed her in the vehicle and dumped her. So this is, again, how difficult things are when you're going to look at these crimes. You have to sit down there. I'm not doing this for this show, but if I were hired to work on this case, I would be going through every single detail of the crime and trying to determine all the different possibilities so I could understand what I should look at and what I should not ignore. But that was the last girl. And then the investigation is now ongoing. This all happened over a year and a half. So by the time they figured out what was going on and they really had a serial killer. Oh, and I didn't get a chance to, I've missed this. Sorry. Brenda's case. There was a note in her pocket. The guy actually put a note in her pocket and it said this. Oh, don't tell me my note disappeared now. What is going on? Hold on. Yeah, my note disappeared. Dang it all. I can't believe it. Hold on a second. Every time I gotta forget something. How the heck did the note go missing? Okay, hold on. I'm gonna try to send it over just so I can show you at a certain point what the note looked like. I'm gonna read it to you so you'll have that knowledge, but let me send it over. Hopefully it'll show up. Just a second. Okay, I've sent it over, but let me read you what it said. Okay, it said, and what's interesting is he had her write the note. This guy was no fool, okay? And that does play into the profiling as well. The guy's not an idiot. He didn't write the note himself because that would be his handwriting. And I guess he was concerned about that, so he made her write it. So he had, remember the other girl, he had make the phone call so that his voice wouldn't be heard. Now he's got her writing the note so his handwriting wouldn't be seen. And they believe it wasn't dictated. They believe he wrote the note and then handed it to her and then she copied it. And it said, "This is tantamount to my insensitivity to people, especially women. I will admit to the others. I will admit the others when you catch me, if you can." And it signed Freeway Phantom. All right. It was a very fascinating note because obviously he'd been paying attention to the media. So he knew he was being called the Freeway Phantom. And he was, at that point, proud of it. You know, he wanted to let everybody know, yeah, it's me. But if you can catch me, and if you do catch me in some way, okay, fine, I'll admit I killed them all, you know, sure. No biggie. But of course they never caught him. So that did not happen. So there were some interesting things about the note, which play into the profiling. One is that he seemed to be intelligent enough to be able to know certain words, tantamount being one of them, because that's not a commonly used word. I would gather an awful lot of people don't even know what tantamount means. Actually, I had to look it up. I didn't write the note. I had to look it up. Oh, that's embarrassing. No, I did, because I'm like, you know, sometimes when I'm on the show, I use a word and then I'm like, did I just say something stupid? You know, I mean, was that, did I accurately say that? I mean, did it mean what I thought it meant? You know, and so then you feel like an idiot. But tantamount, let me just read it to you so you can all not admit you didn't know what it meant. Okay, let me pull it up here. Come on, dictionary. All right. It's an adjective that means equivalent in seriousness, virtually the same as. So in quotes here, it says, the resignations were tantamount to admissions of guilt. So meaning the same as, equal to, virtually the same as. But it's quite an unusual terminology. So the fact that he said that was quite interesting. Let me just go back to my picture here. That is not over to you guys. This is tantamount to my insensitivity of people. So he's saying this, the fact that I'm doing these murders is equivalent to the fact that I'm insensitive to people, especially women. No kidding. You're a psychopath, dude. You are a psychopath. He's not saying he's a psychopath, but he's saying he's insensitive. Okay. Oh, and I wanted to read you something on that note. One of my favorite authors, Stanton Samanow. He's Dr. Samanow. He is a psychologist or a psychiatrist, or is a psychologist, clinical psychologist. He worked at St. Elizabeth's, where the theory that the person may have been in, and one of the bodies was very near, and he wrote this book after he worked at St. Elizabeth's. And at the same time, this was going on. I actually looked up to see whether he knew anything about the Freeway Phantom, but I didn't see it. But I thought this was a really interesting comment in his book. There was a fellow in one of the programs, and in the group, they had a group, you know, who's, you know, the group therapy crap. And he says here, hold on a second. That's kind of fascinating. there's a couple here. I just started reading this. It's really interesting. One guy's name was Leroy. He knew what injury was when his own home was burglarized. He knew when his son was threatened by a boy with a knife. So when his son was threatened with a kid with a knife, and his son was hurt and blood was drawn, that was injury. But he never equated injury. Injury was not tantamount, that's not in the book, to drawing blood, something he rarely did. So he felt he didn't injure others because he didn't stab them with a knife. So yeah, weird thinking like this, very insensitive to other people and what they're going through. Now, here's what I was really coming here for. I just got distracted. A fellow in the group reflected, I do have feelings for other people. If I saw people trapped in a burning house, I'd experience a certain horror. Well, I'm going to say maybe because you don't want to be trapped in a burning house. That's my guess. The man continued, and yet I really don't have any feeling for those I hurt. Were I to rape a woman, not that he did, I'm sure he probably did. Were I to rape a woman, I wouldn't feel one second of her pain or anguish. I can't explain the contradiction between my pain for those in the burning building and my complete lack of feelings for my victims. I think it's because where my own interests and pleasures are concerned, my feelings for others are automatically so totally suppressed and discarded as to be totally absent. I don't know. I only know that if I could appreciate the sufferings of my victims, they wouldn't be my victims. I think that's interesting. So in this kind of group, what he's admitting to is a total insensitivity to other people, except for the burning building people, which I think he must have a fear of his house burning down. That's my guess. Or he burnt himself on a stove one day, and he understands a feeling of pain from that. But the fact that he rapes women or something, yeah, no. So what? This guy's saying the same thing. He's saying that this is tantamount. My crimes are tantamount to my insensitivity to people, especially women. So I don't really give a crap about people, but I don't mind hurting women at all. I don't mind what they have to go through. I don't care that they suffer. I want to get my kicks, and that's that. I'm totally insensitive. So these crimes are tantamount to my insensitivity toward human beings, especially women. Now, having said all of that, and what you heard when I read this, this is a guy that's in St. Elizabeth's Hospital, the one I just read. And one of the suspects that I'm going to bring up in a minute also was in St. Elizabeth's Hospital. And when people go through therapy, this is kind of an interesting thing that happens. They're under the tutelage of psychologists who have studied the human condition. And while they're studying the human condition, they're telling people about it, they often use very sophisticated language, very scientific language, words that, generally speaking, the people that they're speaking to might not know. But if you keep going to therapy for years at that institution, especially a psychopath, he will learn to imitate and parrot that psychologist. So he will suddenly have these fancy terms and this insight, which may not be insight. So the fact that this, he left this message in with Brenda Woodard and used these words, some think, and I do too, that it was likely the guy was in psychiatric care at some point, that he learned those words. Also, that it's also some stuff can be from court documents, and that also is relating to one of the suspects. You get court documents and they have fancier language in court documents. So somebody familiar with the system, been through court, been in a psychiatric institution, somebody who told him you're insensitive, because most of the time a psychopath doesn't even care about the word insensitive. You may not even think about the word insensitive. Why bother? So somebody told him you are insensitive. And then he's like, okay, I guess I'm insensitive. Yeah. And then if they need to, they can use that terminology. Usually when they're coming up for a parole board or they want to get out of the institution earlier, they'll say, look what I've learned. I have learned that I'm insensitive, but I'm not as insensitive anymore. Can I get out early? And that's a psychopath talking. So he hasn't changed at all. All he's doing is using the language of the people who are in control of him so that he can be in control of them. So those are the six. Those are the six women, six girls. I'll call them girls. There's only two that get close to women. One that's actually a woman. The others are girls. Okay, so that's them. All right. I'll stop and look at your comments. And then I'm going to, I want to look at what the, what some of the profilers said and psychologists said, and tell you whether I agree with them or not on this particular case. Oh my goodness. Okay, now, let's see what you got to say here. Oh, Texas Retta says, my mom sent me to the door, which was a couple blocks away. No big deal in the 70s. And you know, this is the thing. It's not a big deal till you get kidnapped. That's the sad part. And depending on how often people are kidnapped, do you want to never walk to the store because one girl in 10 years got kidnapped in the city? See, that's where it always gets tough when you're talking about raising your own children. You know, what do you let them do? You know, do you let them have, do you let them have some freedom so they don't feel like they're trapped in a cage? You know, and how scared do you have to be for your children? How scared should they be? So, yeah, I mean, I walked to town when I was, I believe I was 8. I walked all the way to town. So I can't comment. Somebody, oh my God, how could you let a 10-year-old walk a few blocks to the store? I walked to town and back. My mom, and we didn't have cell phones back then. So, you know, my mom's like, bye, you'll be home before the lights go out. You know, and I would walk to town and go, I remember the stamp shop. There was a stamp shop in town. I wanted to go to the stamp shop. And so I walked to town, but then we were required to walk to school for a darn mile or more. It was a mile. I had to walk to school and I walked home for lunch. Actually, I ran home for lunch because it was uphill. Downhill for lunch. So I walked all over the place when I was 8 years old. And I know that I was 8 because, and I know I walked when I was 6, 7, and 8. And then I moved, from New Jersey to Virginia. That's when I was 9. So if I remember walking all over the other town, that's how young I was. And does it mean no child could be kidnapped back then? No, it's just, yeah. We also didn't have as much media, so we didn't know about these things. Thank God. Stephanie says, I always thought it might be a guy driving a cab who hung around bus stops and offered the girls rides. Interesting. Okay. Think about that. Back in the day, and still today, if you look at Uber, a lot of people are scared to take Uber, but Uber actually these days is monitored electronically exactly where he's going when. So it's actually a safer methodology than a lot of the cabbies. The cabbies, yes, they had to get a license, but I've known enough cabbies that are a little, some questionable cabbies out there. Let's, you know, and if they're not caught, they just continue driving a cab. And most of the time that they're driving a cab, let's face it, most of the people driving a cab are not serial killers. They're just regular people earning a living. Then you get the one creepo dude, right? And most of the time he takes people exactly where they're going. And the one time that he sees somebody standing alone, that's it. They can be gone and he'll never be suspected. So is it reasonable to look at cab drivers? I would say yes, it's very reasonable. And also, in that location, in the city, a lot of people don't have cars And the way they do get around is with cabs. I know my mother-in-law used cabs, and my sisters-in-law, they used cabs. And because if they had to go pick up something from somewhere, they just took, their mother gave them like $5, take the cab. So a lot of people in the inner city, you know, cabs were a way of getting around. And they weren't going long distances, but long enough to get to where they needed to go. They took local buses, local cabs, and they walked more. And those were all three ways that put you out, you know, out and about where something could happen. So if you're looking at possibilities, yes, cab drivers. That's a very good thought. Very good thought. Aisha says, also thought perhaps a person with a larger vehicle, such as a delivery person or an ambulance driver. I would doubt an ambulance driver because that is too connected to the fire department and everybody else is going to see what's happening with that. It's very big and block, you know, it's easy to see. But a delivery person, that's a good one too, because a delivery person rolls around the neighborhoods, going either bringing goods to stores like the Safeway, for example, just to deliver all kinds of delivery services, delivering different kinds of things. But those people know the neighborhood. And one of the, I think almost every profiler and detective agrees upon is, except one of the detectives thought the guy could be from out of state and out of town passing through. I'm like, oh, no. This is a local guy. This guy knows his town. So either he lives right around there or he rolls around a lot around there. So that he's moving up and down the streets for some reason. Could be for work. It could be because he's a stalker type and just likes to drive around. But everybody does believe he had a vehicle. That's for sure. And probably because all the bodies were thrown, most of them were thrown off on the highway, side of the highway, it seemed like for him to pull over and do that, the car would be unremarkable in the sense that you wouldn't go, oh my God, look, why is that ambulance standing on the side of the road? And then you find a body. You see, that would really narrow it down. So it's believed that the car was probably average, something you would not, anybody could have, it could just be anybody pulling over the side of the road for any reason, and it wouldn't be a particularly memorable car. And so that's part of that theory. Do the missing shoes have any meaning? Oh, well, here's where you got to be careful in profiling. It's a good question, Stephanie. Hold on a second. One has to be careful not to overstate things. Are the shoes missing? Because some people say, oh, that's a trophy. He likes to keep the shoes of the girls. Is it possible? Sure, it is. I mean, if you're looking into a suspect's houses, you definitely want to check to see if they got a pile of shoes someplace. I mean, you know, that would be great because that would be fabulous evidence. And he kept the shoes. He goes, this is Diane's shoe and this is Brenda's shoe. You know, he might do that. Or he might, in moving bodies, and supposedly there was a theory that he was washing the bodies, possibly in his own bathroom, undressing them, raping them, redressing them. Is it just he left the shoes off? Possibly. Is the shoe maybe fell off on the way to putting the girl in the car? You know, there's possibilities. Whether it was specifically taken as a trophy, it's really hard to say. I would not know. The bus driver at the end of his route. Yes, that could be, except that I don't believe that there was any real proof that the girls were the last one on the buses. Like one was at a transfer point. So it wouldn't be a place where the guy stopped his route. He would have kept going. So I think the police probably would have looked at that. But that, again, is a good thought, because if you are the last girl on the bus, that's kind of creepy. And I actually was the last girl on the bus once. I actually used to, when I was 17, I'd go from Virginia into Washington, D.C. to go to Junry Taekwondo Studios, where I took Taekwondo. And I took the bus in from, I was 16, I guess it was 16. Yeah, 16. I took the bus from the town I was in, into Washington, D.C. And then when I got out at night, when I finished, it was like 9 o'clock at night. I would take the bus back to Virginia. My mother would wait for me in the parking lot and pick me up. because she knew exactly what time it was supposed to arrive. But I remember being the last girl on the bus because that was like the farthest that the bus went out to. And, you just hope that the bus driver wasn't a creep. I don't know this case, but it seems like Atlanta killer, he would blend in. Yes, generally speaking, if you're talking about somebody who is grabbing people off the streets and neighborhoods, generally speaking, it is somebody who knows the neighborhood well. And back in the day, this was where they were being kidnapped. For the most part, it was an African-American community. So would a white guy stand out? Yes. But then again, as was pointed out, there were white delivery drivers. There were some white people living there. There were white police officers, and police officers did become suspects in this crime at some point, because there was actually two that got nailed for another crime. A girl they thought might have been the seventh victim, but it turned out that wasn't so. But the two guys were police officers who got arrested. They weren't the greatest guys. If you're looking at window of opportunity, you have to be a little bit open to it could be anybody, because if you're driving around and nobody's paying attention to you and you see a window of opportunity, let's say you're in the Safeway parking lot and the girl comes out with her little bag, which she dropped in the parking lot, which was interesting, which means that she probably did not get in that vehicle willingly, or she would have taken the bag with her. So that was an important clue. But if he's in there and she's walking through and points a gun at her and says, get in the car. She gets in the car and he's out of there and nobody saw it, which nobody did. It could be anybody. And so is it likely the guy was black? Yes. And for me, the reason I think so most is because of that phone call that was made, was blaming the white guy. And I've seen cases in reverse where a white guy commits a crime and he takes the vehicle and dumps it in a black neighborhood. So the black guy looks like the black guy did it, right? And so there's that thing, like, let me have them look someplace else. And so for that reason, I don't think a white guy would have let her use the phone and say, a white guy took me. So I'm pretty sure the guy was black. And that phone call, I think, was probably the reason that it's more likely. Leslie says, somebody that would not be threatening, but might even have something to offer the girls and an approach that works to trick various ages. Yes, that was, that's an interesting point that a lot have made, that he would be somebody around that wouldn't make you freak out. But then again, what does that actually mean? You know, if you ever walk into a neighborhood, you see so many types of characters in the city, so many, you get pretty used to them. You get used to seeing, pastors from the church. You get used to seeing high school kids. You get used to seeing a gang member. You used to get seeing a drug dealer. You get used to seeing the guy that works at the store. I mean, there's so many people you see. I don't know for a child what would freak them out particularly, and what would entice them. Now, none of the girls had ripped up clothing, okay? So that would lead one to believe that there wasn't a big altercation at the time they were taken, so that there was a fight and her sleeve got ripped or something got ripped off of her, or, it didn't seem like there was an altercation, that whoever got the girls either lured them into the vehicle or pointed a gun at them and told them to get into the vehicle and then took them someplace and then at that point put enough fear into them that they cooperated or whatever. Yes, it doesn't appear that there was like a snatching, although they said with her, maybe, was she the one with the bag? I'm trying to remember who dropped the bag in the Safeway parking lot. Who was it? I think it was her. Now, who went to Safeway? I said, hold on a second. It wasn't her. Who went to Safeway? Oh, no, it was her. It's this little girl. She was the one who went to Safeway and the bag was dropped in the parking lot. But that just shows to me she did not get into the vehicle willingly, most likely. There was another case I did where I believe that the girl went to sit in somebody's car and put her bag. She'd been sitting on the sidewalk waiting for her friends to show up. And this is a Julie Ferguson case, which I one of my videos is on Julie Ferguson. This is in Greenbelt, Maryland. And she had her drink and she had a bag of stuff she had bought and it was sitting on the curb and she disappeared. I believe she sat that stuff on a curb. She was sitting there already and somebody said, hey, hey. And she said she sat down in the car with them to talk or something like that. And then it took off with her because it didn't look like there was a struggle. I don't think she put her bag in the middle of the parking lot to get into somebody's car to hang out with them. So I think more likely she dropped it when something happened. But there was no evidence that her clothes was ruined. But then again, you can get snatched without your clothes being ripped. So you see, you have to be always, you can say, just because A didn't happen doesn't mean B happened. So we have to be careful of that. All right. So let me read to you from, this is actually from episode 7 of the Tantamount podcast. The link is not below, but the Tantamount podcast is in so many different places. You just have to put Tantamount podcast in and spell it correctly. So this part of the episode, what they were talking about was how they were trying to profile Freeway Phantom. Okay, so now let's see what they had to say. So they went to talk to different psychologists. What do you think? The police officer, what do you think? Who is this guy? And they had some thoughts. One doctor said the killer should be considered quite clever. He was likely to have a sociopathic personality disorder and be able to function in society without attracting much attention to himself. Really? See, here's where people, I mean, what I'm always bothered about is why do you say this if you don't give me a reason why you're saying this? Considered quite clever. Now, the clever part, in some aspects, yes, that if he got the girl to call to make a phony phone call, that was good. If he got a girl to write that little note and he didn't have his handwriting on it, that's pretty good. That he didn't leave much evidence, that's pretty good. But I didn't get caught. Okay, is that clever? Is he clever in everything? So I think we can overdo that because sometimes we find a guy who's done a whole bunch of crimes is a major idiot in other ways. So it's like, we take a look at Brian Koberger. How clever was he? Left DNA at the scene? At least that's the claim. They allege that he left DNA at the scene. He left a knife sheath at the scene with his DNA on it. Unless you believe somebody, the police planted it. Please stop saying that, folks. And he's a criminal justice guy and he leaves a sheath at the scene. How clever is that? He did a bunch of things that were not clever for a guy who had a degree and he was going for his PhD or whatever it was. So, yeah. Then he said he has a sociopathic personality disorder. Okay, that to me is just basic. You're a psychopath. A serial killer is a psychopath. And then he says was likely able to function in society without attracting much attention to himself. Well, I think he needs to explain that. What he's really saying is the guy's not psychotic. Because a person who's seriously psychotic will have so many issues that the neighborhood will know this guy's seeing stuff and hearing stuff and wander around the neighborhood. He probably won't be able to commit a crime very well. He might commit the crime, but not cover it up very well because he's not in his right mind. Psychopath knows what he's doing. So yes, you want to look for a psychopath and not a psychotic. And then this one said, now here's where things get bad. Another doctor at the Springfield State Hospital in Sykesville, Maryland, said that killer was extremely dangerous. Well, he killed 6 girls, so I'm going to say dangerous is kind of like, I think the janitor on the block could say the same thing. He doesn't need to be a psychologist. Bordering on psychopathic extremes in behavior. He's not bordering. He's a psychopath. Such a person would exhibit paranoid delusions. What? He's not psychotic. He's a psychopath. You're supposed to be a psychologist, I assume, and you don't know the difference between a psychotic and a psychopath? Possibly triggered by phonetic sounds. What? Now, I'll tell you why he's saying this. His belief that sounds may trigger an explosion. Okay, at least he explained it. I'll give him credit on that, because if you're going to say something, explain it. His belief that sounds may trigger an explosion of violence was tied to the name Denise. So why was he saying that? It's because there was a Denise connection in these cases. doctors, a number of doctors interviewed by the Washington, D.C. newspapers called out that name and said that the killer had an obsession with girls that had that name. Of course, none of them could explain the real question. There were, I think, three of these girls had, there were some D's in their names, but there was also some middle names that were Denise. I forgot how many now. There were the middle names. I think three girls had the middle name of Denise. None of them could explain the real question. How would the killer know the girls had that as middle names? He's grabbing them off the street. He would not know their middle names. So they went to different schools, lived in different parts of the city. How can there be a connection? It's nonsense. So this guy, this psychologist is saying he's triggered by the duh sound. That's that, you know. So when you're a detective, you want to be careful who you get your profiling done by. Let's see. Another doctor from a state hospital in Jessup, Maryland, said he likely functioned very well in society. Now, a reason he would say that, and again, he should explain that, is because he was able to abduct and kill six girls and get away with it for a year and a half. Consequently, and nobody had been able to identify the guy very well. So he's thinking at some point, now, mind you, this just because during a period of time, like a 2-year period of time, the person is functioning well, doesn't mean they aren't getting caught. They're not in prison or in a psychiatric institute for some other crime. Okay. Just then they're doing okay. It was noted that it appeared that the guy had a job because it seemed that the girls were kidnapped after work hours. So he probably was working and he owned a vehicle and had a house to stay in. And you would to take a girl home in the city, which is assumed he lived probably in the city area. Probably you don't have six people living there with you or mommy, you know, maybe mommy, maybe wife, but not so likely unless they're always out of town a lot. And you can then bring the girls back and not have to worry. So the theory was he more likely lived alone. Well, how did he afford a house if he lived alone? He had to pay rent. And one of the frustrating things in this case is the number one suspects who I'll get into. There's so much missing information. I mean, just no. I like, when did he work? How long did he live there? Did he own the house or did he rent the house? I want to know more information, and it doesn't exist. There's a lot of people put FOIA requests into DC Police Department. I don't know if they did it with Prince George's County. FOIA request after FOIA request after FOIA request. And first of all, a lot of information has been lost, but also they denied all the FOIA requests because they say it's an open case. Even though it's 50 years old, it's an open case. But even in the Tantamount thing, what was frustrating to me is they talked with the detectives. But if you're talking with detectives, why are the detectives giving this information? Why don't they have more information? They've been studying this case. I'm annoyed because you're in there saying, oh, this could be and that could be. No, tell me the details. Tell me what you got on this guy. Tell me all the details about him. I want to know locations, times, dates. I want to know all this information. When did he work where? For God's sakes, if you're going to say, oh, yeah, he worked as this. When? From what date to what date? Because I can't put anything together. But I don't know why that's not done. Anyway, this guy said, along with functioning well, he had a personality quirk that manifested him to opt for strangulation. A quirk makes you strangle people. Okay, oh, my God. Who are these psychologists? This is nonsense. Then you got another guy from Arlington, Virginia, a forensic physician. He felt that the suspect felt inadequate or insecure, and it stemmed from having a weak or absent male or father figure and a dominant or strong mother. And he then had cowardly traits. This is just psychobabble nonsense, pretty much said about everybody. and then he had also analyzed the guy as paranoid and schizoid. Wait a minute, really? Where did that come from? And a likely sadist because he appears to obtain sexual thrills from the use of physical violence. Well, there's a level of sadisticness in every serial killer. There's those that are the types of sadists who take the girl to the basement and torture her for weeks on end. That's a super sadist. But there's a level of sadisticness in the sense that you don't mind causing pain to people. Maybe you enjoy giving pain. Or maybe you're just so insensitive you don't even care that you gave pain to people. It doesn't even turn you on because you just don't care. Maybe his thrill was more of a tease to society. Maybe his thrill was It's hard to say, you know, getting into the mind of the serial killer is a waste of time. I'm not going to be able to do it. And they don't even know why they do crap either. And this one also says he's a megalomaniac, a braggart who labors under a strong compulsion to kill. Oh, Lord, he's got above average intelligence, which again is ridiculous. Why would he have an above average intelligence? What? Because he didn't get caught? All right. Now they say the best profile they got was from former FBI agent Walter McLaughlin, old school FBI, pioneer in criminal sexual classification, which became known as profiling. All right, what did he say? And again, here's my problem. I think any profiler should explain every single thing they say. And not because you're trying to prove you're right or wrong, but because you want other people, the investigators, and other people to understand what you're basing your conclusions on. He believed that the unsub, which was what the FBI liked to call people who haven't been caught, the unsub was a young Negro male. He does explain it. In his words, this is mostly substantiated, and mostly meaning that there's always a possibility this isn't true. Substantiated with his free and undetected movement in the close-knit neighborhoods. I agree with him. He may have a job. Well, I think he did. It seemed unlikely that he could operate the way he did without some kind of income. Or even live in those areas. He may have a job or even live in those areas. He might well live in those areas, yes. In other words, he definitely had a familiarity with the streets he hunted on. I totally agree with that. I think he probably was on them a lot. That's what happens that's why there are these windows of opportunity. When you think the kid just walked a few blocks, why the heck have they gone missing? Well, because that guy has been trolling that neighborhood a lot. And a lot of times he's not going to touch anybody because there are witnesses around, especially in neighborhoods that are busy. You're going to have witnesses, but there'll be that moment when there's no witnesses. But you may have gone down that street 100 times before you got that moment. That's trolling. The unsub demonstrated a degree of higher learning with at least 1 to 2 years of college education. I don't know that that's provable. Now, I don't understand. He has not explained it here. How did he demonstrate the degree of higher learning? Now, mind you, this is a podcast. They may be shortening his profile and leaving out all the stuff he said. So I'm going to give the guy a break. I don't know what he actually said. He demonstrated a degree of higher learning. I would assume that was through the note, the use of the word tantamount and insensitivity. But he could be parroting court documents. He could be parroting psychologists and have no more than a high school diploma. Now, one of the suspects did go to college. And one of the questions you always have to ask is, are people making the profile after they find their suspect? In other words, once you think this is the guy who did it, then you just make your profile based on him. And it's amazing. You know, you said he probably went to college, and lo and behold, the suspect went to college. Oh my God, you know, you thought he had a job, and lo and behold, the guy had a job. Yeah. That makes you a brilliant profiler, but you're kind of cheating because you already know who the dude is, right? Or that you think it is. The killer had ready access to an automobile. That is true. Based on the note he left on Brenda Woodard and his actions, he harbors a hatred toward women, which he basically said, I'm insensitive to people and especially women. So that's not exactly profiling. It's just a fact. Okay. He further theorized that the unsub sought out victims who appealed to him in a personal manner, possibly linked to his mother, wife, or girlfriend. What? Now, this is nonsense. This is the kind of thing that drives me crazy. That's just, you just making that crap up. There's no proof that that's why they appealed to him. Maybe they're just available. You know, who knows? Maybe they're simply available. They would have picked somebody else if they had been available. You have no clue. Oh, what, she looks like my mother, my wife, my girlfriend? This whole nonsense stuff. That has been one of the stupidest things that has been pushed in profiling forever. And a lot of times it would be like, well, the guy picked women that looked like his girlfriend. Well, that's because he lived in the Polish neighborhood of Baltimore, and all the women he picked lived in that neighborhood too, and they all were Polish. They all looked like his girlfriend. Yeah. But nowadays you'll see that with more mixing of races and cultures and all that stuff, you often find that the victims don't look a bit like each other or the person's mother or girlfriend because they were just available. They were convenient. And he didn't really care what they looked like. except they tend to like them small because they're manageable. And cute doesn't hurt, you know. The little trophy does not hurt. So, but there's no evidence of this. And this is just psychobabble again. He didn't see the victims as children at all, simply as females. Well, how do we know that? We don't know that. I mean, he maybe doesn't like females, but we don't know that that's true. We only know that he chose them as victims. Did he choose them because they were smaller? Did he want to kill them because they were children? Did he want little virgins? How do you know that, Mr. Profiler? You don't. I don't know why he chose them. I'm going to say they were available. But, you know, there's a difference between a 10-year-old girl and an 18-year-old girl. But even a psychopathic killer doesn't always choose his victims for the same reason every time. So there can be different reasons. One time it's like, yeah, he wants somebody, you know, the child was just, that was just available. And he didn't realize it was a kid until he kidnapped the kid. And he doesn't care about kids anyway, so he's perfectly willing to rape her. Another time he's like, oh, she's cute. She's 16. I like her. And then there's another time that maybe she's a prostitute. She got in my car, so she's available. Who knows? Get out of people's heads. Okay. The name Denise meant nothing. Good for him on that one. It was simply coincidental that some of his victims share the same name. He believed that the killer had previous brushes with the law, likely being minor incidents. Why? Give your explanation. Is it because you know he knows how to avoid leaving evidence? Is it because he wrote the note and challenged the police? Is that your reasoning? Put your reasoning in. That's all I'm asking. Put your reasoning in, because if that's true, you want, again, people to understand why you think that way. And also, in essence, you're a teacher. It's a profiler. If you're going to give out profiles, you're teaching the next generation of profilers and detectives. Make sure you explain yourself so that they, too, can be better at what they do. His suggestion to investigators was to contact the high school English teachers in the area to determine whether any students they had in the past used or misused the word tantamount. Wow, that would be quite a challenge to contact every high school teacher in the area, English high school teacher, and see if they remember anything. Okay, I can see why you might do that. And you know, then it might stick in somebody's head. Let's see, Dr. Oscar Prado, he was a director of forensic psychology at Springfield State Hospital. He said he believed the killer was akin to a man going on a hunt. All right. Choosing an area to operate in where he would find a pool of potential victims who met his mental criteria. In his mind, this was a white male, based mostly on the fact his victims were black. Interestingly, he said if all the victims were white, he would have thought it was a black suspect. Oh, God. And you're the director of forensic psychiatry. It's unfortunate. It gets worse. He said that the killer was likely a leg man. A leg man. Because all the victims were in skirts or shorts. First of all, a lot of it's summer. Some of them are coming from school. He's a leg man. Oh, goodness gracious. Then he said that the potential suspect would be typical looking in appearance. Well, if you're kidnapping somebody when nobody sees you, you can look like Attila the Hun and don't make any difference. Being in his late 20s in terms of age, why? This was a whole thing that was put out there that he was in his 20s or 30s because he would be, I think the reason was that the 10-year-old wouldn't be threatened by him. Now, for a 10-year-old, I'm going to say a 30-year-old man and a 50-year-old man, what's the diff? What's the difference? The 50-year-old man may look like a grandpa. He might be less threatening than the 30-year-old man. Where are you coming up with the age thing? You know, when you're going to predict age, you have to predict age off of something real. And I don't see anything in here that tells this guy's age whatsoever. Not one shred of anything. Evidence proves what age he is. I can tell you he's not a high school student because he has a vehicle and a house to go to and probably a job. It's unlikely he's a high school student. It's more likely he has at least got some years on him. And he's got a lot of control. There's no question about that. He controls things very well. He keeps somebody for a period of time, does specific things to them, then redresses them and dumps them in a location which is intelligent enough place to dump them. He plays a few games. He likes control. As I'm going to say, he's got some life experience. But that he has life experience doesn't put him in an age range to me that I can particularly point out, other than he's probably not, 20 years old. He's probably at least closer to 30 or 40 or 50 or 60. I don't know. Oh, Lord. He would be an unreliable employee. Why? Why is he unreliable? Because he's a serial killer? I mean, some serial killers are really good. There are some who are good employees. They go to work every day, clock in and clock out. They do that for years and nobody suspects them because they're so reliable. It is true that guys who are what I call slow killers and fast killers. The slow killer is the one that does the abduction, takes the girl like this to the basement, keeps them for a while and does specific things to them. Those are usually people who are actually, they can maintain reasonable employment because they have the ability to follow through on things. The ones who jump out in the park and whack people over the heads and rape them right there and run away, they tend to be a little bit sloppier in their jobs and they do things that piss people off and they get fired, and they're usually the ones that are more sketchy. But even they can keep jobs for a period of time. So where this guy comes up with that the guy can't keep is an unreliable employee, there's not one shred of evidence. Most likely working in some sort of blue collar capacity. Why? What makes him a blue collar worker? Is he a plumber? What is he? You know, I mean, does he paint houses? Couldn't he do some? What is it? What does it matter? Well, he could be a mail clerk. He could be a computer guy. He could be what puts him in a blue collar category? If you're going to say that, and I don't see any evidence of that. He said the person I'm looking for is potentially suffering from a Superman complex with grandiose delusions. Now, most psychopaths are pretty grandiose. He was complex and consumed to the severe hatred of women. He said he did. Prado was the only person authorities consulted that suggested the Phantom was a white man. Okay, well, the rest of them weren't there. And the whole, I'm going to go through all the other shit. No, I'll skip that silly stuff. Let's see what the FBI, one of the basic FBI profiles said. Victims were essentially low risk of being targets of violent crimes. Yes, this is true. When you look at low risk and high risk, essentially high risk comes under things like prostitution, drug use, party girl, being out and about in a careless fashion, perhaps very available. That makes you a high risk victim. These girls, for the most part, were not. I mean, there were things said about Brenda Woodward. She was having some issues. But the rest of the girls were simply going home, going to the store and coming home. They weren't high risk, except for the fact that what made them susceptible was their age and naivety. They were young. I'm going to say this. If somebody points a gun at you, and this guy, I wouldn't be surprised the guy had a gun or a knife or something to get them into the vehicle. He could have offered them a ride. She might have taken the ride. Some of the younger girls, I don't think they're going to get in somebody's car. They're just walking home. They didn't need a ride. So I would feel then they might have just had their little arms grabbed and been chucked into the vehicle. And that's that. So I don't know that their naivety really did have much effect here. But the risk factors that made it, the risks higher where they were combined, they were alone at night and outdoors. Yeah. So basically, if there's no witnesses where you are, you're out and about and there's no witnesses, that puts you in a little, your risk goes up. And I always tell people that, as far as being safe, just understand that witnesses will keep you alive. That's why you don't go running at dawn. That'll get you killed. Hopefully never, because you'll be one of those that never got attacked, but your risk goes up. The common denominator was being adolescent black females alone at the time of initial contact with the killer in highly populated areas. The FBI concluded the killer was not someone they knew, but a stranger. I agree with that. They determined that the nature by which the victims were killed, depositing of the bodies, and the fact they had no relation to the attacker all point out and is, quote, is our conclusion, was that these homicides are perpetrated by the same assailant. Yes. The offender offset his risk somewhat by approaching the older victims later at night. That's true. Again, that's when they were available. Maybe got in his car. His approach to prey was to not apply immediate physical force. The lack of defensive wounds seems to suggest that for at least a time, the victims were willing to be in the company of the offender. I don't terribly much agree with that. Either they did not perceive him to be an immediate threat, or he was able to gain complete control of his victim by fear and threat of immediate and serious bodily harm. And that's all it takes, a gun or a knife. Get in the car. Grab their arm, get in the car. It's not that hard. More likely suggested that the offender used a combination of the two. All right. And then he controlled them with the threat of a weapon, so on and so forth. Let's see. Opportunistic. Yes, I agree with that. Let's see. I thought this was a good one. I did say it. I like this one. See, they explained this one, so I appreciate this. The offender reduced his risk of having the bodies connected to him. If confronted near the disposal areas, he could simply have an alibi as thousands of other travelers. I was just driving down the road. It was a very busy road. You could easily be driving down the road. You could even find the body. Oh, my God, I saw the body out there. If somebody stopped, said you were there, you go, you know, I thought I saw something. You could say, no, I pulled over for a second because whatever. You know, you make up an excuse. This procedure also offset the offender's risk of being seen in the short amount of time it took to dump the bodies. He essentially removed any chance of being identified by killing the only witnesses he believed to exist. That's true. But I will say this. The fact he used the 295 corridor through DC, this is the highway, and there's places on that highway you can pull over. So it's not exactly what people think. Sometimes you think of a highway as being something like, you know, eight lanes across and you can't get off of it. This is not like that. There were a lot of places you could pull over on that highway. Because I drove that highway all the time, and it's very easy to pull over. And there's a lot of roads coming in and out of it. So lots of ways to dump a body there. Then they go, the killer was likely between 27 and 32 years of age. Yeah, sure. This was arrived at by examining the ages of the victim, the degree of trauma inflicted, the amount of control the killer had to use over his victims, and to a lesser degree, the willingness of the victims to initially be in the presence of the killer during the first contact. Absolute nonsense. I don't see any point in any of this stuff. The FBI admits, though, that the age of the killer was difficult to assess. Yeah, you shouldn't have done it. You could do what I just did, which is saying I doubt he was 20 because at that point he appeared to have a relative amount of control and experience, possibly with the police or the psychologist. He had a car, he had a job. I'm going to say he's not 20. But after that, I don't know. I'm going to leave it open. It proved difficult for them to compare the chronological and emotional age of the Freeway Phantom. No kidding. But then they say, however, no suspect should be eliminated based on age alone. Yeah, exactly. That shouldn't happen. All right. They go a little further. They said he was smart, possessing a high school education and likely a higher education such as college. Again, I think it's the word tantamount. The killer most likely held down a full-time job. All his victims were confronted after what would be considered normal working hours. Their bodies were all disposed of late at night or early in the morning. The early in the morning interests me because one of the suspects, if he worked in two of the places where it is claimed he worked, 295 is on the way to both of those work locations. So he could have had done them in and then put them in his vehicle and on the way to work, dump them. I find that really interesting. He didn't have a desire to rob them because they didn't have any money. That's true. The FBI believed he would be working as a delivery man, postal worker, medical assistant, a role in security, the military, or possibly in recreation. Okay, I have a hat. Library assistant, CVS worker. What the heck? These are pointless, absolutely pointless. And again, if you're going to say he was in security, you better explain it. Why would he be in the military? Explain that. Why is he in recreation? What the heck? What does that mean? You teach basketball, therefore you might be a serial killer? I mean, I don't even understand it. He was able to have relationships with people, even women, but likely does not have the skills to maintain healthy relationships. Yeah, mostly because probably when he committed these crimes, he didn't live with somebody. But we all know there are people, Dennis Rader, who had a wife for many years. Quite a few people had wives for years that they were committing these crimes, and a whole family. So they were keeping up their relationships. FBI believes he's single or lives alone or with an older significant female. He follows his crimes in the media. Well, we know that because he wrote that note, or had Brenda write that note. They said he had his own vehicle. Now look at this one. They acknowledged the killer owned his own vehicle, a late model car, and kept it well maintained. Unless you have a photo of this car, a video, what the heck? Well, how would you know what? How would you know it's not an older car? And how do you know he maintained it well? What, again, where's your reasoning on this? That's why I'm not too fond of a lot of FBI profiling, because I think they make stuff up and they don't explain where they're getting this crap from. The Freeway Phantom was not a drinker or drug user. Well, again, you don't know that. At least they say during the times of his crimes. Okay, so theoretically, he wasn't so trashed on alcohol or drugs that he made totally stupid mistakes. Okay, I can go with that. Doesn't mean he didn't. He could have had a few drinks before he went and grabbed a girl. Just because he successfully did it doesn't mean he's totally drunk. He could just get that liquid courage thing. He could have that going for him. So again, you can't say these things and don't know. His control obsession would not have allowed it. Okay, he did like things being under control. So do I believe he was strung out on horrible, really tough drugs? No, I don't. I agree with that. The use of such substances would have lowered his inhibitions and possibly ruined the experience he felt. Wait a minute. I'm not going to say that somebody who has a couple of glasses of scotch is going to have his rape experience ruined. I mean, people have scotch all the time to have a better sex experience. So, hey, rape is one of those things. It's not really for sex, but you know, it's a power thing. But hey, what a thrill. Maybe it does enhance it. Cocaine could do the same job. That's a lot of this, again, is in the profiler's head. All right. So where are we at? All right. Okay. Now I'm going to get to the suspects in this case, but I'll check with your comments first before I go to the suspects. And there's not many. So I'm only going to do the Vega gang, the Green Vega gang, and a guy by the name of Robert Askins. He's the number one suspect, but he supposedly has been eliminated for some reasons, which I'm not sure I agree with. Okay, so, Molly says, he seems a little like Bundy, who said, I'm the most cold-hearted you will ever meet. Well, all psychopaths, violent psychopaths like the serial killers, they all are all cold-hearted. There's nothing nice about any of them. And they may appear to have niceness. Like you might have a guy who takes care of his dog and he pats the dog on the head and he gives it little kisses. And he's like, my dog's my best friend. One day the dog annoys him, so he shoots it in the head. His concept of love might be a little squirrely. Let's see. Leslie says he could have a good learning capacity and wants to look intelligent. That's a good point, because tantamount is a big word stuck in a simple sentence. The rest of the sentence is simple and states the obvious. This is true. He may want to impress the police or the media, because he knows he's going to the media. He might want to impress them to say, see, I'm not just this loser. You know, I am a smart man. I think that's a very good observation. Stephanie says, these profiles are only getting worse. Leg man, oh my God. This is the problem with profiling. Profiling has gotten a really bad name over the years, and rightly so, because we have too much nonsensical stuff being put out there that is not, in my opinion, supported by evidence or logic. I don't even like the concept of, a lot of people think it's psychological profiling is often used. I don't believe in psychological profiling. I think it's a terrible word because, quite frankly, when you come down to serial killers, for example, they're all psychopaths. I don't need to psychologically profile them at all. I mean, it's just stupid. They are what they are. What I believe you call it is two things. criminal profiling. In other words, we're profiling criminals and criminal acts. That will include physical and behavioral evidence. Those are, and circumstantial evidence, those are things, evidence from the scenes. His behavior at the scene, and that's not to say that he's, to go in and say he doesn't like his mother, unless he's got a picture of his mother there and stabs it, unless that. But it's to look at his behavior at the scene to see how he does his stuff in order to narrow down who the suspects could be. You look at the circumstantial and the physical evidence to do the same thing. Crime scene analysis is the proper term, in my opinion. So I call myself a criminal profiler / crime scene analyst. I do not like the word term psychological profiling. And I think too many people roll down that route, and Criminal Minds on television goes down the stupid psychological profiling thing where, you know, you put your hand to your head and you go, he's old, you know, and you just make up stuff. He's a leg man. Maybe the profiler was a leg man. You know, that might be. I hope no one paid for these profiles. Yeah, you know, I think the sad thing is, again, because there are psychologists and psychiatrists and profilers, and the investigators think, well, I should go there and they're going to be able to help me narrow things down and point out who it would be. And a lot of people who are working as detectives on the police force, they haven't studied these things. They have never studied criminal profiling, which I think is a mistake. I think every detective, especially detectives going into sexual homicides and homicides, or sexual assaults, sex crimes, or just homicide. I think they should all go to detective school. I think it should be a reasonable length detective school, where not only do you learn this, the basic mechanics of being a detective at that level, but you also study crime scene analysis, behavioral analysis, and you learn all those things so that when you're there on the first day of the job, you have a lot of experience with you understanding how to analyze these kind of crimes. And you don't have to run around town going to every Tom, Dick, and Harry psychologist going, what do you think? And the guy goes, I think he's a leg man. And you go, well, you must know more than me. You know, I don't want people to know more than the detectives on the case. I want the detectives who have studied it, but not to study nonsense. I want them to study very useful methodologies of profiling. And I'm not fond of the FBI methodology. I would like to see them do deductive criminal profiling, not inductive. And so that's a whole nother part. When I do my online school part, I will do these things and explain each one of these things. But that's what I'd like to see, these detectives. Because the detectives in there, just to be realistic, detectives on the case are doing criminal profiling. They are the criminal profilers at the scene. They need to be able to do their job. They need the training. Because running around trying to get a whole bunch of other people's opinions and then coming to criminal profilers sometimes 5-10 years after the fact is not useful. No. So I think the detectives are the ones who have to do the job. Let's see. Stephanie says, it's interesting that the victims didn't have signs of torture or beatings, even though he kept at least one of them for several days. Speaks to his control methods and possibly motivation. Yes, they did. And they didn't have any signs of being tied up either. So I'm not sure quite what he did. I'm going to say he locked them in someplace. The ones, especially the one he kept for three days. I'm assuming he locked her in to a room and she didn't know what to do. She's a child. So he says, here, I'm going to give you some food. She has some fruit in her stomach. So did he just say, here's some bananas, you know, eat that. There's a bathroom down here. Use that. And then she just sat on a bed and waited for whatever was going to happen. And she didn't beat herself up. And he didn't feel a need to tie her up because she's a kid. And he just locked her in the room. That would be my basic concept on that. Let's see. They did not have visible. I don't know about the safe stuff, that he was safe. I think he had to have a weapon. Why? No, most of these girls had no reason to get in his vehicle. They were just going home from the store. So I don't think they felt safe with him. I think that they were, maybe the older girls were taking a ride because they didn't want to wait on the bus. Or maybe one of the girls took a ride because she did that quite often. But the other girls, the other four, I would say very unlikely that they willingly got into a vehicle. So I'm going to have to say they were threatened in some way, told they had to get into the vehicle, and they responded. Or they could have done the old trick. Your mom says, I should give you a ride home. And a lot of kids will jump in a car for that. just because they assume that if the person said their mom wants you to come home now, that their mom said that. You know, they're not, kids aren't that bright. They'll fall for stuff. So that would be one of my theories. Okay, let me go to the suspects. Let me first talk about the Green Vega guys, because I don't think it's them at all. All right, so let me just pull that up here. Okay, the Green Vega guys. Who they were was this. They were rapists, okay? Among those individuals considered suspects or members of a gang known as the Green Vega Rapists. They're running around in a Green Vega. Okay, that's a great moniker. Members of this gang were collectively responsible for numerous Washington, D.C. and surrounding Maryland vicinity rapes and abductions that occurred near Washington Beltway. Logical investigation, intimate knowledge of the modus operandi of the Green Vega gang brought them to the forefront. And they were interviewed by a bunch of people. And they eventually, some of them got prosecuted for rapes. But not like these kind of abductions and rapes. It was not like this. So what happened was one of the guys during some of this stuff supposedly said, oh yeah, well, this guy did it. These guys did it. And they kind of ratted out their maybe trying to get some kind of benefit. You know what I mean? So, one of the detectives said, oh yeah, they said things that nobody else knew, but then supposedly, yeah, they did. That was actually in the media. So the problem I have with this is this. This is not more than one guy. This is not a guy who's in a gang. This is a solitary serial killer who very methodically and carefully committed his crimes and got his own sense of thrills out of it. And he was careful and how he committed them. And it's not like some guy running around with a bunch of crazy people, just jumping out of the cars and raping women. It's just that's not happening here. He's not a party dude. He's a guy who is solitary, focusing on what he wants. He wants the 100% control. He's not going to get that with a gang. So, and there's no evidence of a second person involved. So my belief is one person, not the Green Vega gang. That just was a distraction. And the couple police guys who were involved in, let's see who they were. Edward Sullivan and Tommy Simmons were two ex-cops arrested for the murder of Angela Denise Barnes, who was not one of the six. She was 14 and at one point was thought to be a victim of the serial killings. They later determined that Barnes was not a victim and that because of other reasons that, yeah, she wasn't connected. Now, let me go to the guy who is the number one suspect that some say has been eliminated. Some still think it's him, even though there's reasons that supposedly he's been eliminated. So let me get to him. His name is Rob. He's a creepy dude, let me tell you. That's a creepy guy. Here he is. Let me find him. Okay. Here we go. Now, interesting enough, this is the only photo they have of him. There's a lot of FOIA requests going in saying, look, This was a picture actually taken at a distance with a whole bunch of, I think, three other guys. And they're looking for his mug shots, and they can't come up with them. So they're just not seeing it anyplace. And nobody will give it to them. So what the heck? But it's one of those things. We'll never know the truth of that. So anyway, in March of 1977, wait a minute. I want to find the beginning of this. Oh, that's not the beginning. Where's the beginning? Okay. Hold on. I want his early life because it's okay. Okay, it's basically this. Okay, at 58 years old in 1977, this is like 5 years afterwards, he was a 58-year-old computer technician. He was charged with abducting and raping a 25-year-old woman inside his Washington, D.C. home. Homicide Detective Lloyd Davis, he's the number one guy who thinks this is the guy who is the Freeway Phantom, proceeded to question Askins and learned that he had been charged with murder on several previous occasions. Okay, now here's his history. December 28th in 1938, Askins, then a 19-year-old student. He was a student at the Miners Teachers College, which is now Howard University. Okay, I thought that was it's an interesting history. He was at the Miner Teachers College, Howard University, on Georgia Avenue, in D.C. He was a student there and a member of the science club. So he's not was definitely not a dummy. If you want to believe this guy, the Phantom, Freeway Phantom, was relatively smart. He was in college. He was in college, and he served cyanide-laced whiskey to 5 prostitutes at a brothel, resulting in the death of 31-year-old Ruth McDonald. On December 30th, only 2 days later, he stabbed to death another prostitute. By the way, one of the girls was stabbed. I forgot to mention that. Stabbed to death another prostitute, 26-year-old Elizabeth Johnson, at the same location. Upon his arrest, Askins declared to police that he was a woman hater and was placed under mental observation at Washington, D.C.'s Gallinger Hospital. That is now known, well, it became D.C. General, which, by the way, is along that 295 corridor. All right. That same. It's right along that as well. And he was there, but it was called Gallinger at the time. While there, he broke free of his restraints and assaulted 3 orderlies with a chair before being subdued. During his trial, it was revealed that he had been a police informant, aiding law enforcement in the arrest of prostitutes. In April 1939, he was found criminally insane and committed to St. Elizabeth's Hospital. Okay, so now we have a guy who's been in college. He's not stupid. He is a woman hater. He says that. He hated prostitutes. He killed 2 of them. The first one about the cyanide thing, supposedly he said he was like playing Russian roulette sort of. He's going to take the cyanide himself. And I think it's a whole bullshit story. But I think he was playing Russian roulette with the ladies. And then he stabbed one. So he hated prostitutes. He used prostitutes, mind you, but he hated them as well. So he did have an issue with women. And he was relatively smart. And he was a police informant. So he knew, he had knowledge of how police work. And then he goes to St. Elizabeth's Hospital, which is where the first body was found near. Okay, now, what more about him? 5 months after being released in 1952, he strangled 42-year-old Laura Cook to death. He was indicted for this murder. Wait a minute, first he was 1952. So when did he go in there? He was, so in 1938, he went to St. Elizabeth, and he got out of St. Elizabeth in 1952, or just at the end of 1951. He was in there a long time. So he was in there like 12 years. He had a lot of therapy. He sat in therapy group after therapy group after therapy group. And he learned stuff. And he was probably told exactly what kind of guy he was, that he was insensitive toward human beings and women. It's tantamount to being a pretty awful guy. All right. So let's see here. So he gets out 5 months after he gets out in 1952, he strangles 42-year-old Laura Cook to death. He is indicted for the murder in 1954, accused of several other assaults of similar circumstance and retried for the 1938 murder. It had been determined he was indeed sane upon committing the act. Despite claiming he intended the cyanide for himself, planning suicide, he was convicted of second-degree murder and sentenced to 20 years to life. Oh, now you think, okay, thank God, this guy's off the streets. But no, it's our United States court system. The conviction was overturned in 1958. So now he's back out again. Now, so after he was back out again, during the 1970s, 1971, 1972, he was out and working in Washington, D.C. He was not arrested again until 1978. And he was in his 50s when, early 50s, when these things occurred. Now, we have a guy here. I don't see why any girl would be, why it matters whether he's 30 or 50. He's got experience. He's got the hatred of women. He's got the connection to St. Elizabeth's Hospital. He's worked with the police as an informant, you know, psychology, you know, and he's gotten out again. He's learned a level of control and how to manage things a little bit better, theoretically. And he does work, all right? He works. As I said, he worked as a, now get this, okay. He worked as a computer technician. All right. So he had a stable job. Now, here's what I was annoyed with. I want to know, when did he get the computer technician job? How many computer technician jobs did he have? Where did he work? And from what dates? Because when you're going to analyze a suspect, you want to know where their home is, where their work is, where their hobbies take place. Like maybe one of your hobbies is playing, let's say you like to play. Okay, let's say you play tennis. What tennis court do you play at? Because a tennis court might be near where the victims disappear. Or let's say you take a second job at night. Where is that? Where are your relatives or your friends? You know, did one of your friends live right in the Southeast neighborhood where two or three of the girls went missing? He didn't live in Southeast. He lived in Northwest. Oh no, he lived in Northeast. Sorry, he lived in Northeast. I'll show you some pictures of the. I'm going to try to show you some maps. May not help, but I'll try to do it. He lived in Northeast. So the first two were in Southeast. So did he travel there for no reason or did he have a reason to be there? So you would want to know with a suspect like this, who were his friends? Where did they live? Who were his relatives? Where did they live? Where were his jobs? Where were his hobbies? I want a list and there's zero on it. What they do say is that he was a computer technician. Well, goody two shoes. I mean, where and when? All right. Then it goes on. 1978 rape charge. His home was searched by police in connection with the Freeway Phantom murders. That happened with the rape charges. Apparently, he had kidnapped these prostitutes and raped them, and then he washed them, gave them baths, which is they said the girls had also been bathed. You know, so he was doing that with the women he had raped. They searched his house. Court documents found in a desk drawer, in which there were these papers in the drawer. From a judgment he got from a judge. And it had used the word tantamount in those papers. So there was the word in his house. Also, it was an uncommon note, that uncommon word that was used in the note, but it was on the paperwork in his house. Also, furthermore, and who knows how true and how much they were pressured to say certain things, his colleagues at the National Science Foundation, okay, the National Science Foundation is here. That's in Virginia. If he's up here and he's living up here and he dumps the body on the way to work, he'd be going out here to Virginia. Remember when that girl said, oh, it was a white guy took me to Virginia. I'm in Virginia. He worked in Virginia. And it was on the other end of the 295 corridor that the bodies were all found on. Did he, as I say, did the guy kill the girls and then on the way to work dump them? Sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes, maybe. Maybe, but the people at work National Science Foundation, they said that where he was employed, reported that tantamount was a word that frequently cropped up in his speech. So he used the word tantamount a lot. Now, again, I'm not an investigator in the case. I don't actually know when he worked at the National Science Foundation because there's not any exact dates on that. I don't know who these people were that they interviewed. I don't know how they interviewed him. I don't know if the people who claimed he said that he used the word tantamount were encouraged to say that. I don't know how many people they interviewed. You see, this is where the lack of information comes in when you're on the outside of the case. So, I mean, does it sound pretty good that the word was on a paper in his drawer and he was saying the word over here too, like it stuck in his brain? Yes. Is it interesting that he also was in St. Elizabeth's Hospital, close to where one of the bodies was? Is that interesting? And where he would have learned the psychological stuff about insensitivity and all that? Yes, it's interesting. Where did he live? He lived in a, I'll show you where he lived. He lived in a, one of my pictures. Hold on, I'm going to run through them so I can figure out. Okay, down at the bottom, you will see 1700 M Street Northeast. That's where he heck is that? That is really weird. It's a way to get to. I'm trying to figure out the picture now. That's a really strange picture. That does not make sense to me. Hold on a second. That it really doesn't make sense to me at all. Okay, something's wrong with that picture. Sorry, something is wrong with that picture. I think it pulled up a different M Street. Gets very confusing sometimes. Okay, I'm looking for the one that I had that made sense. Okay, here it is. Okay, I have to move this because I got to see. Okay, up there at the top, yes, up there at the top, you'll see M Street Northeast. That's where he lived. He lived in a row house. The row house apparently had a basement. It had a way to pull in and park and not be seen. And he lived alone, supposedly. So he could go, he could grab a girl and he could go to his house and he could keep her overnight or for a few hours or whatever he wanted to. And then he could go down right there. You'll see that whole blue line. He could go straight down there and out to his job in Alexandria, Virginia at the National Science Foundation, if he actually worked there at the time. Or he could have worked any place else, because we don't know, because their information is not there. It's so annoying. I have a lot of pictures of when I looked at his house. He's in Northeast Washington. He's in a location which is close enough to a whole bunch of other, you know, Southeast Washington, Northwest Washington. He's in the middle there somewhere, which is not far for him to be able to take a girl and transport her back to his house. Not a big deal. And he's right, the 295 corridor, clearly he's able to access. Now, that doesn't mean he did it, because there's a whole pile of other people in town who could do the exact same thing. And one of the interesting things, the one thing that makes me wonder whether he did it or not, is that there is a truth to the first two victims were from the same neighborhood. And oftentimes when somebody starts a series of serial killings, they start with their own neighborhood, like less than a mile from their house, a place they really know, and they grab them from there. And then after they're like, after that second one, maybe they saw me, then they grab from a different location and try to set the trail away from them. So the question is, did the guy live in that original neighborhood, right where the first two girls were kidnapped in Southeast? He did not live in Southeast. He lived up here and not down here. So now he could access Southeast within minutes, but that's not the point. The point being that many serial killers start in their neighborhood. And that would be one of those things I'd say, well, let's look around the neighborhood and see if it's somebody else. Now, what makes it look like it could be him? Well, he's a rapist. He is a serial rapist, and he's already a serial killer. He killed how many, he's a serial killer. There's not a question about Askins being a serial killer. He is one. He did focus on prostitutes, but that doesn't mean he can't change up, right? Maybe because he'd been caught with killing prostitutes, he thought he would then sneak around and do something else. He did have the word Tantamount associated with him. He did have a private location to take the victims to. He is relatively smart. He's got all kinds of interesting little issues which match this case extremely well. But that's only from the outside, because I don't know all the details. But just because he has those things doesn't mean he's the guy. Now, what makes people think it's not him? All right. He's dead, by the way. Now, he died. He died in prison because he got arrested in 78. When they went through his house and his car, they found no physical evidence linking him to the crime. What were they looking for? Trophies? Which he didn't have any. Now, mind you, this was 78. The last girl was killed in 72 that they know of. There's 6 years. Either he stopped doing it, he started getting worried he's going to get caught if it were him. He may have, at that point, simply gotten rid of anything that could connect him to the crime. He could have dumped every souvenir if he had any at all. They couldn't find the thing that put green fibers on the girls. They thought it could be like a bath mat that he could have, when he was washing them up or whatever he was doing in the house, he could have had them on this bath mat, and they got these green nylon threads. They were very tiny. Some thought it could be from a car, something in a car. They never identified where those green nylon threads came from, but it's been 6 years. He could have thrown the damn thing out. If he had something on his floor or in his car that he used, it could be gone by now. So that doesn't mean it's not him. Now, the last thing, this is the most interesting one. And here's where I don't know the truth. And I wish I could find out. One of the reasons they didn't believe it was a white guy who attacked these women was that there were Negroid hairs and in their underwear area and a few other places. One time they found a blonde hair or something, but they think that was some paramedics. But supposedly they found these hairs that were not the girl's hair, but were a African-American male's hair. All right. That's another reason. That's good physical evidence that who you're dealing with here, and probably not a white dude in this case. So yes, could be him. Now, They said it, those hairs did not match him. Okay. Now, there's only one line. It's been tossed into the media. And here's the problem. I don't know if that's true. I don't know who did the testing. I don't know how the testing was done. I don't know what hair they even had. If they only had the shaft of the hair, they couldn't do DNA. And DNA would tell them more, but they didn't have that. So how did they know it wasn't his hair? How did they know? Did they put it on a microscope and say it doesn't look like his? But here's my question. I want to know the hair that they found. This is all the information I don't know. Of the hair that they found that was not the girl's hair, supposedly, how many pieces of hair did they find? And each one of the girls, how many did they find? Was it one over here, two over here, one over there? What? I also want to know if I would assume, and this is, see, when you assume, the old saying, you make an ass out of you and me because you think you should do this. Those girls' hair should be, each one of the hairs from each one of the girls should be excluded from the hair that they found on another girl. Why do I say this? Well, let's say the guy had a green rayon, I don't know, maybe had a drop cloth, you know what I mean? Maybe had some cloth in his house that he used when he brought the girl in and he dumped her on this cloth. That was his way of not contaminating his house. He dumped the girl on a cloth. Does it mean he washed the cloth every time he dumped a girl on it? Or is it possible he used the same cloth to dump another girl on? Can we say it's not another girl's hair that's there? Now, I would assume that the supposed killer's hair, let's say you've got five pieces of killer's hair. I assume, first of all of these under a microscope somehow match. And then if you've got six girls over here, that you've made sure that not one of these hairs here matches any of the girls, just in case that was happening. Now, here's another problem. Let's say none of them match those girls. And let's say there's five pieces of hair and they all match. So there's one person who left those hairs. If you don't have the root of the hair, you can't tell if it's male or female. So you can't say it's an African-American man's hair. All you can do is say it's from an African-American person. Now, if this guy liked to bring prostitutes in his house, how do we know the prostitutes weren't on that green thing too, leaving their hair there? Who knows? I mean, I just don't know what they have. That's what bugs me. And when they analyze this against him, who analyzed it? How was it analyzed? How was it proven that it wasn't his hair and it couldn't have been somebody else's hair? And it could it have been a female's hair and not a male's hair? I don't know. And so I can't come to a conclusion that he is not the guy because I don't understand exactly what the hair analysis proved, except for that one line. It wasn't his. And I don't believe things that I don't see the paperwork on. and in this case, that's it. One sentence. If I put a FOIA request out, would they give me that information? Probably not. So I don't know whether it's true or not that they actually could prove that there was that it couldn't have been him that was involved in the crimes. Now, is he the best suspect? 100% absolutely. Absolutely. But does it mean he did it? No, it doesn't. And I say the one thing that stands out to me, that only thing really that stands out that would lead me away is the first two crimes. Did the guy come from that neighborhood? Because that is sort of a thing that happens with serial killers. They pick the neighborhood they live in, and then they veer away from that neighborhood. And so should we be looking for somebody in Southeast Washington and not this guy up in Northeast Washington? But then again, I don't know where the dude was completely at that point in time. I don't know. Did he have relatives down there? Was he doing some work in the neighborhood? So he was there. So in the evening, he had driven down from Northeast for some reason and was in that neighborhood. Maybe he was the kind of guy, even from the beginning, says, look, I already dealt with the police system. I'm not going to touch anybody in my neighborhood. I'm going to make sure I drive over there. So they think somebody from that neighborhood did it. He could be smart enough to figure that out. So I can't eliminate him because I don't understand the hair evidence. Other than him, I don't know that they ever had another decent suspect. He's like the only one. But it hasn't been proven that he did it. But boy, there's a whole lot of things that make it look like him. That's all I can say. A whole lot of things. All right, I'm going to go to your comments on this. Let's see. He hates women because he thinks they make him weak. Who knows? Again, this is something it doesn't matter. I'm pointing this out from a profiler's point of view. Trying to solve a crime and determine who committed the crime, it doesn't really matter. Now, if you're trying to treat somebody, okay, in a situation where you're giving therapy to somebody, yes, you might want to delve into their background to help them deal with their problems. But as a profiler, I don't care what he thinks. I don't care what his issue is. Like Jack the Ripper and his first victim. What about Jack the Ripper and his first victim? What about him? I'm not sure what that means. And Aunt Jeannie says, was the hair all consistent with the hair found on each victim? Have not a clue. I have no idea. Not a clue. He could have had a girlfriend in the neighborhood or have lived there in the past. Yes, he could have. It could be a neighborhood he goes and picks up prostitutes. And maybe during his prostitute picking up time in that neighborhood, he couldn't find any that night. Who knows? They say he could be smart enough to say, I'm not going to grab anybody in my neighborhood. And he learned his lesson, for example. We really don't know. So if I were working the case, I would definitely be looking for people since it was, serial killers often do start in their first neighborhood and then move out. I'd be focused in very heavily, I would, on who's in that neighborhood. But you come across a guy like this, you didn't know he was even involved. And when you arrest the guy and you go, dang, this could be the guy. You can't just say, my profile said the guy probably lives near the first two victims and therefore he didn't do it. My profile said he's 30 years old and he's 50, so he didn't do it. That's nonsense profiling. You don't do that. So while it helps you focus in on where you want to do your investigations, you don't eliminate people because the simple fact is there is not 100% absolute on any methodology a criminal uses. They change up. They change their MOs. And then you get your anomalies and you go, well, that just blew everything to hell. So profiling is meant to analyze the evidence and help build investigative choice of what avenues are the best to look at. So if you're looking at something and you say it's very unlikely that this is a whatever, then because it's unlikely, so unlikely, that might not be your first choice of putting your investigative efforts into. You would want to go someplace else. Like this is, the chance of this being a female serial killer like that. So you're probably not going to spend a whole lot of time looking for a female serial killer. Now, theoretically, could it have been a female serial killer? Well, yes. The only semen they seem to have, and again, I don't know the validity of this, it seemed to be the boyfriend's semen. I just don't know the truth in that because, again, we don't have proper information. But let's say it's a female serial killer. And that's why the girls got into the car willingly. Like, she's like, hey, you want to ride home? They said, sure. And then they attacked her. Now, you say, well, she was raped. Okay. You can rape a person with an object. You can pick up any object in your home and you can commit a rape. You can sexually assault somebody without being a male. Okay. So you could have a woman in there sexually assaulting her and doing all those things and taking her out and dumping her. The victims were small. Maybe the woman was a strong woman. Could this be a female? Yes. There's no evidence that it couldn't be a female. Would I be looking for a female? No. No, I wouldn't be. Will somebody see my video now and will the internet go berserk and now they'll say Pat Brown said it could be a female? and they'll misquote me. And now there'll be somebody does a show and gets 100,000 views, and all because it's now the Freeway Phantom is now a female. I wouldn't doubt it, because people go off on tangents like this. If you're an investigator, would you look at this as, would you look at men first in this, or would you look at females? Well, unless you have some reason to look for a female, you probably are not going to spend more than 0.01% of your time looking for females. You're going to be looking for a male, but it doesn't mean it couldn't be a female. As a matter of fact, it doesn't mean it couldn't be a white male as well. Now, there was some Negroid hair, supposedly, that went to girls. So what? Again, maybe the white guy brings back prostitutes, and it's a prostitute's hair that's on the cloth, and then the other girls are dumped on, and then the hair's mixed up. It could be a white dude. After all, the girl said a white guy took her to Virginia. Could be. Is it likely? No. But white male, keep it in mind. Female, you can keep it in mind. But what are you going to put your investigative avenues into? You're going to look at the most likely places for them to live, where the connections might be. You're going to look for those witnesses. You're going to look for anything you can to narrow it down to a more likely suspect, not the least likely suspect possible. Now, if suddenly you get some information in which leads you away from that, you go, oh, I'll be damned. It does seem to be this white guy, or, you know, this very large woman. She's like an Amazonian woman, and she's been saying stuff about kidnapping girls. Maybe it is her. You don't have to discount it, but you also don't have to spend most of your time on it either. So let's see. No, he did not name himself. That was the media that did that, Stephanie. The significance was that the bodies were all dumped next to the freeway, majority anyway, and they didn't know who he was. So that's why they came up with Freeway Phantom. One of the interesting things about the note, and let me see if I can pull the note up, because I tried before and I failed. Let me see if it showed up yet in my picture collection. Yes, here it is. Show up. Wait a minute. Here it is. Okay. It's a little blurry and a little small, but if you look at the bottom, it says Freeway Phantom. And that became an issue. Why did he put a hyphen? Why did he, because the girl supposedly copied. The theory was he didn't just tell her this, that he had her copy it. Now, again, do we know that he had her copy it? No, we do not. He could have said, write these words down, and he could have said Tantamount, and she could have looked up and gone, how do you spell that? And he goes, T-A-N. He could have dictated it. So there's not proof that he didn't dictate it. They're just theorizing that because of the way it was written, that he probably wrote it and said, copy this. All right. Freeway was written with a hyphen in the middle. Freeway is not written with a hyphen in the middle. It's written like this up here. Freeway. Why did he put a hyphen in there? Unless she wrote it, and unless he dictated it and she threw it in there because she didn't know any better because she was a kid. So they looked up all the reasons why you could put a hyphen in between free and way. I looked that up myself. I couldn't come up with anything of particular interest that, you know, that would be like he came from a particular area because everybody in the area put hyphens in between free and way. One possibility in my mind is that the reason the hyphen was there was to put free separately. So he's like, I'm free. I'm the Freeway Phantom and you haven't caught me yet. But I'm making that up. I don't know if that's true. So, you know, sometimes you'll try to figure out things based on, hey, this is interesting. Could it have any meaning? But you got to be careful. As I said, you can find meaning in everything, and you can connect so many dots. You really can. And it doesn't mean it's true. I say, I can connect my husband with my ex-husband, like the high school that a couple of girls were connected with, that he lived right near Howard University. This guy went to, he had a basement in the house. He could have dragged people into it. He had that blue Volkswagen. Somebody saw, and I don't believe these girls went in a blue Volkswagen personally, but okay. But you know, I think at the time he was, 1972. Let me figure that out. He would have been 13. wait a minute, I don't think you could have driven the car. Oh, see, now he's off the hook. He found out he's 13 years old. You can all stop thinking my ex is a serial killer. So, but you see, this is you got to be careful. And there are a lot of times when you read books, they will take these concepts and they will just elaborate on them and make whole chapters out of them. And when you come right down to it, they don't hold a lot of meaning. If you're actually working the case, you've got to be careful that you do make sure that what you're focusing on has at least a relative amount of legitimacy. I think this guy, I think it's hard not to include him on your suspect list because he is a serial killer. First of all, that's a big thing right there. And he has enough of those dots to warrant a warrant to search his house. Unfortunately, they didn't come up with the physical evidence they needed. They could never prove anything. He supposedly later made a statement that he didn't. What did he say? They said they contacted him later on and they asked him about his role in the slayings. And he denied any role in them. And he said he did not have the, quote, the depravity of mind required to commit any of the crimes. He killed other women. He raped and killed other women, but not those women, because his mind would have to be more depraved to kill those. Maybe because they were children. Maybe that's his thinking. Maybe it's true. It may be that he would never have killed anybody that young and who wasn't a prostitute. Maybe he thought prostitutes deserved to be killed, but children and teenagers did not. So maybe he's telling the truth. His depravity only went so far. You know, but you have to look at him. But then while you're looking at this guy, you don't want to have all those eggs in that basket and then not look someplace else when turns out it might be some guy that lived in Southeast Washington where the first two victims were and they just overlooked him. I'd love to see, except they lost most of the files or whatever happened to him. I would love to go back through the files and see what other suspects they had, especially from that area, and see whether I found someone that was more convincing than this guy. But the case will remain unsolved. I think the police put good effort into it. I know a lot of people think it's a racial component that they didn't care enough about the six girls. I don't think that's it. I mean, there have been same problem with, when you had a number of white women killed, you have the same problem. It's just that a lot of times they're not connected as serial homicides. The police are trying not to tell the public much because they don't want the panic to ensue and they don't want the media all over them. So they're doing work, but they're doing it behind the scenes and nobody thinks they're doing anything. So a lot of times that's the way it goes. So I don't know that was so true in this case. But, that's just my thinking on that. See what other comments you might have. Well, there's an interesting one, Aunt Deanie. Free way to get sex rather than paying a prostitute. Well, there you go. See, we can make up all kinds of good stuff. I like it. It's this is a free way. That's a good one. You see, if you play the game long enough, you're going to come up with 50 different ideas behind that one thing. You know, so the same thing with the body being found near St. Elizabeth's Hospital. He did spend all that time at St. Elizabeth's, and he did drive the corridor, so that makes him interesting. But what if the guy didn't even know St. Elizabeth's was there when he dumped the body? Maybe he wasn't paying a bit of attention. Or maybe he was visiting a relative that was there and he knew the place was there and he just thought, I'll blame it on a crazy guy and dump the body there to blame it on a crazy person. He never even went the place. So you see, got to be careful. You got to be careful that, does this prove anything? No, I use the word interesting. Interesting is a safer word to use. There's a lot of things I find interesting, and the interesting things should be looked at, examined further, but not be considered some kind of locked up profile where, oh, well, the guy is clearly 30 years old and hates his mother. I mean, and then you find a guy who's 30 years old and hates his mother and you go, there you go. It's that dude. No. Crazy. Interesting case. Sad that it was never solved. If you listen to the Tantamount podcast, you do hear a lot of the relatives, and it's more of an emotional thing than it is anything that's going to get you any further than I did today. Perhaps even not as far. It's people who like podcasts. For me, I always find them very slow, and I get frustrated with the hearing stories that go on, and I get frustrated with the hosts who, ooh and ah over everything, and have those very nice voices. You know, they're like, and then we're going to be talking with, Mary Smith, because she was the sister, and Mary, how did you handle this after your sister went to the store and went missing? You were the one who sent her, and then Mary goes, oh, and then Mary tells her sad story. And that's the kind of thing people do like to listen to. They like to get into the human side of things, and that's nothing wrong with that. It's just not, I did listen to the whole thing, but mind you, because there was so little out there. And when I went to read Wilma Harper's book, I found that this was mostly a sociological study more so than about the case. And in the reality, there's just not that much information out there. That's useful information to prove anything outside of the fact that he still looks like the best suspect there is. So that's that. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed this story here. I only like podcasts on a long drive, and they're very good for that. You know what I mean? It keeps you awake, and therefore you can get involved in it. It's really good for driving. I have to admit that's kind of nice. And some people use it, as a sleeping aid, like people use me as a sleeping aid. You listen until the person's voice drones on and they just put you to sleep. And then you wake up and go, oh, where was I? And you have to go back and use it the next night. So, that can be done. But I thought it was a very well done podcast. So I'm going to say that. I thought it was well done. They had the detectives, I forgot to put her up here. Oh, I did. I forgot everything here. They had the detectives come on to discuss their involvement in the case and all the work they did and what they think after all these years. So you get to hear from a lot of people. I think they did a good job of that. It's one of the better podcasts that I've listened to. I didn't get very upset by it. Some podcasts are highly agenda driven. I did not find this one agenda driven at all. I just found it. It was a good podcast. I'm going to say that. I will give this one credit, and I will, and I'll put the information about it in the description below, because I think it's worth listening to. If you want to, hear from the families and the detectives, I think it's good. Gives a good whole feeling of also just what happened at that time, what was going on in 1971 and 72. I say it's well done. That's all I can say. It's well done. They have a lot of money to make a good podcast. it's a quality podcast. Let me put it that way. So anyway, I'm glad you learned something, Aunt Dini. I hope so. Otherwise, I serve no purpose whatsoever. Sky Ricky says, thanks, Pat. Such a sad story. Indeed. Great analysis as usual. Thank you. Six girls and young girls who just doing nothing, not doing anything wrong, especially in this particular instance, this wasn't even, generally speaking, bad behavior was not here. These weren't girls getting themselves into trouble, making stupid choices by doing drugs and, getting involved in dangerous professions. This girl going to the store to buy some dog food. That's painful. That really is. So I'll see you all next time. Absolutely. Bye. I'm glad you were here, Leslie. And so anyway, I will be back during the week with another, if you haven't seen any of my Cleopatra series yet, I'm going to be on number 9 soon. There's only 2 left in the series. If you want to check it out, go to these playlists and look at the Murder of Cleopatra. That's my whole entire, my book I wrote on that. And it's a 10-part series on her life and death, which will take you far away from the Queen Cleopatra Netflix nonsense. And please check out all my playlists, all the shows for the other cases. And the Hangouts are more like a kind of relaxed, let's talk about all kinds of things type of thing. So I'll see you at the Hangout sometime later this week. And glad you were here for sure. And see you next time. Bye.